Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for joining me, and thank you as well to Dr. Brent Roussin for joining us here again this week, and for all of your work, Brent, thank you so much, and to your whole team. Just 2 days ago, Dr. Roussin and I announced that the additional public health orders that were put in place for the May long weekend to limit gatherings in an effort to decrease transmission rates that have typically spiked over holidays and long weekends would be extended through this week until Saturday morning. That was to allow our officials and our public health leaders to monitor the case counts, the hospital capacity, the effectiveness of the current public health orders, which are already the most strict in the country. While Manitoba's COVID-19 case counts have somewhat improved over the past few days, our healthcare system is still facing critical pressures, which is why today we are announcing new and stronger public health orders that will be in place for 2 weeks until June the 12th. These new and strengthened orders specifically target gatherings, workplaces, and retail establishments. Manitobans must stay home as much as possible over the next 2 weeks so that our hospitals and our medical teams have the capacity to care for Manitobans, have the ability to care for people when they need that help, not just COVID patients, but others as well, many of whom have been waiting for medical treatments. So this means for the next 2 weeks, no indoor or outdoor gatherings with members outside your household. And this includes all recreation spaces. This includes playgrounds, golf courses, parks, sports fields, campgrounds as well. Work remotely as much as possible. Shop online or curbside as much as possible. In-person shopping is limited to one member per household. Increased requirements will be brought in for malls to manage capacity and access to ensure compliance, and especially within common space areas. Many businesses and organizations will remain closed for in-person service, including gyms and fitness clubs, restaurants and bars, personal service businesses, museums, galleries, and libraries. We need Manitobans to stay home as much as possible for the next 2 weeks. Nous avons besoin que les Manitobains restent à la maison autant que possible pendant les deux prochaines semaines. We're not in a position to reopen, and we are not in a position to send our students who are currently in remote learning situations back into the classroom either just yet. Which is why today we are also announcing that K-12 schools in Winnipeg, Brandon, Dauphin, and in the Red River Valley and Garden Valley school divisions as well, will continue with remote learning for a minimum of an additional week. Public health and education officials will continue to monitor the situation closely, but it is our goal that students will be able to return to in-class learning the week of June 7th. Our priority has always been to keep our students in the environment that they learn best in, and that is, of course, in the classroom with an educator there to assist them. And to the greatest extent possible, that is what we'll continue to strive to do. I want to commend our teachers. Thank you to you. I want to commend our educators, so overall, our school administration and division staff as well. Thank you to you for your proactive and collaborative work during these very challenging times to keep parents and families informed, and of course to look after the best interests of those young people in your charge. We thank you very, very much for that. I'll pass it over to Brent now for further details.
Well, thank you, Premier. Good afternoon. I'm Brent Roussin, Manitoba's Chief Provincial Public Health Officer. We're implementing new and strengthened public health orders for the next 2 weeks, and this is because our healthcare system is under great strain. Our ICU numbers, our hospitalization numbers are extremely high and still expected to climb. The public health orders outline what we need to do to bring down these numbers. We need to stay home, work remotely whenever possible, go out only for essential items and only when absolutely necessary. Do not gather with anyone outside of your household. We recognize that these next 2 weeks, like much of these last 15 months, are going to be difficult. Manitobans are tired, but our healthcare system is depending on us to bring down these numbers. So these new public health orders will take effect Saturday, May 29 at 12:01 a.m. And these include restrictions that we've become familiar with. So indoor public gatherings are not permitted, and visitors are not permitted on private property except with a few exceptions. Outdoor gatherings with anyone from outside a household are not allowed, and this includes playgrounds, golf courses, parks, and sports fields. Retail businesses may only operate at 10% capacity or maximum of 100 individuals, whichever is lower. Only one person per household will be allowed to enter a business. Many businesses and organizations will remain closed, and this includes gyms, fitness clubs, restaurants, bars, personal service businesses, museums, galleries, and libraries. Some of the additional restrictions that employers are now required under the order to allow employees to work from home wherever possible. Malls will have increased requirements to manage capacity and access to ensure stronger compliance. In addition to the orders, remote learning for K-12 schools in Winnipeg, Brandon, Red River Valley, and Garden Valley School Divisions will continue in remote learning until the week of the 7th at the earliest. And Dauphin will continue to in remote learning until June 9. And I would, and you will begin to see public health more actively use orders under the Public Health Act to close individual facilities, businesses and workplaces where we're seeing multiple cases and transmission. This means that a factory, office, or warehouse may be ordered to close if we're identifying transmission in that workplace. And we know businesses, for the most part, have done a great job at protecting their employees, but they do have that responsibility to ensure employees are following the fundamentals and preventing transmission to ensure now their business continuity and prevent the risk of closure. We know we have to take stronger action to help protect the health system and the health of Manitobans. Right now, we have hundreds of people in hospital fighting for their lives. We have thousands of health providers working day and night to help these Manitobans. We have to stay at home as much as possible. We have to reduce our close contacts, wear masks, wash your hands, stay home, especially when ill. And we have to get vaccinated. So many Manitobans have been vaccinated. We continue to vaccinate more and more Manitobans every day. Please, if you haven't yet booked your appointment, please book your appointment for vaccine. If you have any questions, speak to your healthcare provider. The more vaccine uptake we get, the more we're going to protect Manitobans, the sooner we're going to start being able to look at lifting these restrictions. So the Lila Supersite has capacity, and encourage you to book at that location if you're 18 plus. In fact, today and tomorrow, the Lila location is now open to walk-ins. So please, let's get that message out. Let's get the vaccine uptake. And we have some opportunity right now just on a walk-in basis for today and tomorrow at that Lila site if you're 18 plus. So we're going to continue to make more and more vaccine appointments open for both first and now second doses for certain eligible people. And so these are all the steps that we can take right now to start bringing down our risks. So it's that collective action that we've all been working for so long for, but we need to continue to do it for a bit longer. So practice the fundamentals, stay home, and thanks again to all Manitobans. I'm going to pass it back to the Premier.
Thanks very much, Dr. Roussin. These decisions aren't easy ones, as everyone knows, but we recognize especially a difficult and challenging time for everyone right now. There's COVID fatigue, and it's real. There's fear of the unknown as well, as we've seen an escalation in the number of cases in over recent weeks. In response to that, some weeks ago, we implemented some of the strongest measures in the country. We've added to those. We've also consistently implemented enforcement to back up those public health orders for the few that necessarily need that enforcement as a motivation, I suppose. These are tough measures because we are in a tough situation, and our need is to protect each other and to safeguard our healthcare system for all of us. We need the full participation of all Manitobans in order for these strict public health measures to work. Measures don't work by themselves. We have to work at those measures, and they will not be effective, and we will not get our lives back as rapidly if we do not have the buy-in from Manitobans to support these measures. And so I encourage all Manitobans to make sure they do the right thing here and abide by these measures so that we can do what we've done before, bend that COVID curve down and sharply, and get our lives back as soon as possible. The more we follow the rules, the more we beat COVID, and the faster we get our lives back. We've done it before, we can do it again. We'll beat this third wave if we do two things. Go and get a vaccine. If you've had one, sign up to get another one as soon as you're eligible. I'm looking forward to doing that myself in a few, I hope a few days' time to order up an appointment for my second vaccine, and I encourage all Manitobans to make sure if they've got their first one, get their second. If they haven't got one, go and get your first one as soon as possible. Best vaccine's the first one you can get. Nous l'avons déjà fait, nous pouvons le faire à nouveau. Nous vaincrons cette troisième vague si les Manitobains font deux choses. Se faire vacciner et suivre les ordres de santé publique. We have a couple of tough more weeks ahead of us here, but we all have the ability to help shorten the length of this third wave, just as we delayed the advent of this third wave. And we want to get back to doing the things we love, the things that we miss, the people we miss. And so here is our opportunity to work together to achieve that goal. Remember that the best vaccine is the first one available. I urge all Manitobans 12 and over to get vaccinated as soon as possible. We have 9 super sites, one in Gimli, Dauphin, Steinbach, Brandon, Thompson, Selkirk, Morden, 2 in Winnipeg. We have 150 other options, including pop-up clinics and making an appointment with your neighborhood doctor or your pharmacist to get to their office to get a vaccine from them. These options are open, available to you right now. To make an appointment, just go to protectmb.ca. We all have a role to play in protecting ourselves and our loved ones and our community. Join Team Manitoba. Get vaccinated. Follow the public health rules. As a government, we've ensured that employers and employees have the protections and financial supports that they need so they can take time off and give time off, so a COVID test can be done, so that you can stay at home when you're sick, so you can take time off to get a vaccine. Thank everybody for using that sick leave program and encourage everybody that they can have that time to do those important things. But we have to remember, even after you're vaccinated, and for all of us, the level of caution remains and must remain high. These vaccines aren't perfect. We're very thankful they're here, and we're very thankful for the people who helped develop them, but they're not perfect. And we need to be very, very vigilant as we move forward. Stick to the fundamentals. Stay home as much as possible for the next couple of weeks. We'll get through this together. Thank you. Look forward to taking your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Premier. Thank you, Doctor. A reminder to our reporters on the line, you will have one preliminary and one follow-up question. Up first this afternoon from the Canadian Press, Steve.
Good afternoon. We've heard from people who work in shopping malls that they have become sort of a de facto meeting place during this third wave. And I'm wondering if you can tell me some detail as to this plan of yours to ensure that malls manage capacity and eliminate gatherings. How can that be done?
So this is, again, part of the capacity limitation. So we have strict capacity limitations on 10% or the 100 max for stores. We've also put in these orders that these malls are directed to evict people who are gathering with others. And so there's going to be that burden. When we have that one person per household rule, that's what's meant. There's of course few exceptions for that, but our messaging is clear. If you have to go shopping, it should be for essential reasons, going in, going out, and these malls are not allowed to tolerate gathering within them.
And Dr. Roussin, 8 deaths reported today. We were just handed that, so I haven't had a lot of time to go back. But to my knowledge right now, this seems to be the highest one-day number of deaths during the third wave and going back several months. How bad is this going to get before we see the slight reduction we're seeing now in case numbers translate into the hospitals and the ICUs?
Yeah, and so certainly our condolences and hearts go out to their families and loved ones. It's it is a high day than what we've seen so far in the third wave. It just again tells us we need to bring down these numbers. This is the strain on healthcare system. We're not just counting cases; these are Manitobans, and these are 8 more Manitobans that we've lost now. And so we need to focus, to bring down that risk, to stop these transmission chains, and that's going to be our fastest way to protect ourselves, and then again, the reminder to Manitobans to get vaccinated as soon as possible. We really don't want to see days like this again.
From CTV Winnipeg, Michelle.
I'm wondering about this requirement for businesses to have employees work from home. How is that going to be monitored, and how are you going to make sure that these businesses are doing as much as they can?
Yeah, well, I think with like many aspects of the orders, the specific and detailed enforcement is sometimes difficult. We don't usually get into the details on how exactly we're going to enforce it. We don't put things in the orders that we're not capable of looking at enforcement. But again, it's we've said this all along, is these orders, the fundamentals, are all ultimately guidance to Manitobans. That we need their help. And so we've messaged this. Now we're clearly putting into order. If you're an employer and you have employees who can work remotely, we must do so, right? We're at a critical stage right now. And so don't look to see how it might be enforced or how to work around it. Anyone who can work remotely, get them remote right now. We have many weeks looking ahead of us here, so we need all Manitobans to do their part.
Okay, thanks. I'm wondering about the June 7th return to school target that you've set for these regions. Why have we chosen this date, and what does this mean for schools that are outside the regions that you've noted in these new orders? What are they supposed to do?
So we have, what we know now with our numbers is that we just weren't in a position to return on that original June 1 date, right? Like we've mentioned, and we're not the only jurisdiction. Most jurisdictions work under that the assumption that with these orders, the schools are last to close, first to open, and so we're still looking at that June 1. Given our case counts, given what we're seeing, we just weren't prepared to do that. But we still are trying to get that happening again on June 7th. For the other schools, we're taking the targeted approach, the similar targeted approach that we did earlier, that if we see transmission occurring, if we're in a high-risk situation, then we might have to put other schools at remote.
From City News, Stephanie.
Hi there, Stephanie Lasuk from City News. Just again, kind of touching on these businesses that aren't already allowing their employees to work from home. How do you expect this new order to work if they haven't been doing it the whole time, or especially in the last few weeks where we've seen our case counts? Don't worry about the enforcement, but can you ensure that there will be some sort of enforcement if rule breakers are found in this regard?
Well, I mean, this we've been messaging this and many of our waves, including this one. This time it's in the order. And so it's certainly capable of being enforced. And so that's our message, is we need all Manitobans to do their part. And if this is just yet another way of doing that, but it's in the order, so it certainly is enforceable.
Okay, and Mr. Premier, can you just confirm that government offices have sent all employees who are able to work from home at this point? Because we're hearing rumors that would suggest otherwise.
Well, I can only tell you that up until a couple of weeks ago, I believe we had, last numbers I had, Stephanie, were approximately a third of people were back working in government offices, but we'll confirm those numbers for you. And yes, I understand that the messaging has already been developed to get out to government employees that whoever can possibly work from home will be certainly encouraged to do so.
From CHVN, Taylor.
Hi, good afternoon. There's not a whole lot of change in these health orders, except for essentially being extended. And some doctors have been asking for a larger shutdown. What else have you looked at to ensure people are staying home?
So, I mean, I think there's, if we're talking about a lot of change, we're fairly restricted already. There wasn't a lot more to restrict. And so I think that right now we've directed people who can work remotely to be able to do so. And plus we've changed now this focus, not necessarily closing the non-essential businesses, but for essential and non-essential businesses, we're going to be having that ability to close businesses on a targeted basis where we're seeing transmission occur. And so we have, upped the steps here. We're having businesses are required to report two or more cases to us in their facilities, and we're going to be taking that quite seriously. So I do think this is certainly an escalation. The degree of it is probably challenging just because we were quite restricted to begin with.
Thanks. And that June 7th and June 9th return date to school is very close to the end of the year. Why wasn't it decided to go remote for the rest of it?
We've decided that we need to do that. I think we've always committed to having the kids in school as much as possible, and so we're going to do whatever we can to still do that this year. And of course, it's going to depend on a number of things, but we're still looking to do that.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Larry.
This question for either the Premier or Dr. Roussin. If, given the crisis in our hospitals right now, why not close non-essential retail for a few weeks to get us through this situation?
Well, I can start with that one, Brent. We just announced additional restrictions together last Friday that started last Saturday that put us as the most restrictive province in the country. Understandably, those were strengthened over what were already very strong and arguably the most stringent restrictions in Canada for close to a month before that. But no restrictions work unless people work at them. And so the emphasis today is to further broaden what were already the most restrictive measures in the country. We have no gatherings allowed. We have 10% retail. We don't allow people of faith to gather in any number, unlike every other jurisdiction in the country. And so these restrictions are designed to reduce interaction among our citizens and reduce the transfer of COVID and its variants. they need to be followed. We've stepped up enforcement. We have the toughest enforcement in the country. Our numbers last week were 46% higher than the week before because we've added people. We've strengthened enforcement to encourage compliance among those who wouldn't want to follow the rules without it. Each of these measures will not work unless people work at them, and they will not work in the short term. But it is our hope that they will work as a consequence of the restrictions a couple of weeks ago. We believe that we may see some positive downturn or plateau fairly soon. We think that that may be evidenced by some of the recent numbers, but we aren't out of the bush yet, not even close. And so the strengthening of these measures today is essential, and additional enforcement, which is, you can be assured, will be happening to make sure that we don't just have the strictest rules, but we have as much compliance as we can possibly get.
My follow-up questions for Dr. Roussin. You now have the power to close certain businesses if you see outbreaks occurring. I'm wondering what you're seeing in terms of the numbers, case numbers involving various businesses, and when can we get more information about how COVID is affecting different business sectors?
Yeah, I think we're going to work on getting more public-facing data on acquisition and transmission events. If we look overall at acquisition events, we see about 10%. Both acquisition and transmission related to workplaces right now. And so that's still, significant numbers. And then there's that risk of then bringing that home to a household. And so this is why we're going to be taking that more targeted approach. But if we're seeing transmission within workplaces, we want to address that. And that may require temporary closure of those businesses. So we know that there is still transmission occurring within workplaces.
From Global News, Joe.
Hi there. So we've heard some concerns about the amount of learning loss that's going on with students. So has there been any talk at all about having students repeat a grade or something like that?
I'm not aware of any serious discussion at this point. I've heard the reports as well, Joe. I think it's simply a matter of fact that we really have made efforts to keep our schools as safe as possible for our students and staff, and we've also endeavored to work with our administrators and educational leaders to keep our schools open as much as we could to avoid that loss of learning that happens when kids aren't able to be closer to their instructors and to a learning opportunity. There's also a mental health aspect to this I should mention that is really important, the social interaction that students lose when we remove them from the school environment's a real thing. And so clearly we've made every effort to encourage that learning environment to be supported. And our educational reforms as a government are designed to enhance that opportunity for more resources at the front line with the teachers where the kids will benefit from them.
Thank you. And I realize this might be looking a little too far ahead on a day like today, but other provinces are aiming for a summer with a lot fewer restrictions. So given where we are now, does Manitoba still have a shot at something like what other provinces are aiming for?
Yeah, I'm not going to be Pollyanna here. We're in the middle of a real serious challenge for our people, all of us, and everything we can do to follow those restrictions and get vaccinated as soon as possible and stay safe is really going to help us. There's hope in the window, and we'll outline some of that next few days, Joe, but the fact of the matter is right now we got these two challenges in front of us. We've got to abide by the health orders. They're tough, but they're necessary, and we've got to make sure we get vaccinated when we have the opportunity. First or second, both are important. Can't have the second one until you have the first one. So I'm encouraging 40% of Manitobans that haven't yet, that are eligible and haven't yet had a vaccine, to please make sure they go and do that as soon as they possibly can.
From the Brandon Sun, Kimberly.
Good afternoon, Premier. My question today for you is Is there an extension to the bridge grant for businesses that are being impacted by today's announcement?
Well, today's announcement, Kimberly, for the most part, unless there's clusters or a reason to restrict business behavior, doesn't change the orders we announced last Friday. But we have had some of the most generous supports and easiest to apply for and to get in the country. And so we take our support of our small business population very, very seriously. And those discussions will continue. We have other endeavors planned already in the planning stage to offer even additional incentives and supports for our small businesses. And I wanted to say a special thank you to our small business community for the tremendous and the vast, vast majority of these folks have worked hard as anybody has in the province to comply with their health orders all the way through this pandemic. And we know better now than perhaps we did before the pandemic how important and vital our small business folks are to this province, not just as employers, but as community people. So a special thank you to them today.
Thank you for that. Dr. Roussin, this question is for you. In today's COVID update, a woman in her 30s from Prairie Mountain Health Region died. Do you know if she was being prepped for transfer out of Brandon?
Yeah, I don't have any specific details, and we don't really discuss the specifics of an individual.
From CJOB, Clay.
Good afternoon, gentlemen. First of all, Mr. Premier, the weekend's coming up. I have a message for anyone planning to organize or planning to attend any anti-restriction rally in Winnipeg or anywhere in the province.
Well, my message has been pretty simple, Clay, and straightforward, I hope, all the way through this thing. If you want to save lives, you follow the health orders and you get vaccinated. And if you don't, I think you need to really reflect on that. You can either be part of the solution here or you can be part of the problem. We got 8 people who lost their lives today. They had loved ones. They have family. So think about that a little bit before you decide to go out and start acting against a public health order. Just give that a little bit of thought and think if that was your mom or your daughter or your son or your dad. Think about that for a minute. If you think, maybe you'll act differently. I hope so.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Scott.
Good afternoon to both of you. I guess this question is probably for both of you, but your own doctors have pleaded with you to close non-essential businesses and issue a stay-at-home order. And we continue to ship patients to Ontario, which has, you know, has more of those orders in place. Why aren't you listening to frontline doctors?
A couple of things, Scott. You're wrong on your assertion about Ontario having more orders than Manitoba. And secondly, when we need help, we ask for it, and we're getting it from Ontario right now. We also need help from Manitobans to abide by the public health orders, which are extremely stringent and hard for people, but they are needed to be followed for us to get out of this COVID third wave. So continue to ask for Manitobans' help to do the right thing and follow public health orders and get vaccinated.
Thanks for that. Maybe you can explain then to Manitobans how these are more stringent than a stay-at-home order and closing non-essential businesses.
Well, I'll start, Brent. Ontario calls their stay-at-home, but they actually allow gatherings for church get-togethers. They allow 25% retail. You can go through the chapter and verse of the Ontario rules. They're restrictive. Ours are tougher. And Brent, we've added some things today that toughen them up even further from last week's announcement.
Right, yeah. And so, you know, if we look at workplace clusters and transmission, we certainly see transmission occur there. We see it probably more so in what would be termed the essential businesses, businesses that wouldn't be closed if we closed those essential businesses or non-essential businesses that are already at that 10% capacity. So we find that this targeted approach is going to will result in some businesses being being closed as well.
Okay, we'll call on Clay for his second question. Are you there, Clay? All right, moving on from CBC Manitoba, Bart.
Hello, Dr. Roussin. Why did you wait until this long, with hospitals in crisis, this late in the third wave, before ordering businesses to close if they have clusters of COVID cases?
Yeah, and so again, this isn't part of this order. The ability to do that, using a health hazard order, is always under the purview of public health. So we've always looked at that. It has been utilized in the past. And so we're just really shifting the direction on this, you can expect more and more businesses to be required to close if we're seeing transmission there. So it's we didn't wait on it. We've always had that ability. It's been utilized, but we've really shifted the focus. Rather than closing sector-wide, we're going to focus the targeted approach on where we're seeing transmission.
Okay, can you explain this further then? Because Ontario has made public all along when they've had, or almost all along, when they've had specific workplaces, specific businesses that have required to close. You or your office in the past has refused to identify them, that there is no, quote, public risk. But quite frankly, I would assume there's a risk to the family members of the people who work there. A lot of people don't have the luxury of working from home in manufacturing, food processing. So if you forgive the lengthy preamble, can you explain why more businesses were not ordered closed over the past 2 months?
Yeah, and so we still used many public health approaches rather than necessary closing. So we do our, you say that there's a risk to the families for sure, but that's dealt with through our contact tracing and follow up in that area. So that still might not require a public notification on that. The public health approach was taken, contact investigation, outbreak investigation, isolation of contacts and cases. And so now this is, a clear escalation to workplaces that if we start seeing transmission, you could be looking at a temporary closure.
Our final reporter this afternoon from CBC National News, Cameron.
Hi, gentlemen. Listen, just on the targeted approach, at what point do we start to reassess the targeted approach? Premier, going back to Scott's question, you keep saying we have the most restrictive restrictions in the country. Ontario's non-essential retail is closed. Malls are closed. I can walk into a mall in Winnipeg and buy a set of golf clubs. How do we square that?
Yeah, that's the one difference. But again, they allow group gatherings, which we do not. So when you look at the overall effect, you're right. There's one aspect of Ontario's restrictions that is tighter. There are several others that are not. They're looser. All this talk about the rules is important. The health orders are what we're here to announce today. But there's another factor. That's the willingness of people to follow the rules. That's a key determinant in the model that public health uses to ascertain what is effective and what is not. There's been some criticism of us for not bringing in total close down rules. Someone said 2 months ago, we had 4.5 weeks ago, I think we had 100 cases. We were under 100 most of the time for the first 4 months of the year. How do you imagine the public would have been affected by introducing public health rules when we had fewer than 100 cases that restricted all non-essential retail? Do you think we would have got buy-in from the public? So there's a factor to consider that the public health people have to consider here. Plus, what is the mental health impact of closing your small businesses all down and putting people out of work all over the province of Manitoba when you simply because there are a lot of cases in Quebec or in BC? These are not easy decisions to make. They're difficult decisions to make. And we are doing the absolute best we can with the facts we have. And I think that Manitobans will abide by these health rules if they wish to see us get out of this mess. Most are. I hope all will.
Well, Premier, on that, you've been saying yourself this week that some people are not buying into these rules. When do we change the strategy here? When do we go from asking people nicely to stay home to making people stay home?
Well, the instant that I went hard on those who were disobeying the rules, I was suddenly characterized as blaming people who get COVID. So you see the delicate balance here. You know, there are people who are choosing not to get a vaccine. They're going to remain part of the problem until they get a vaccine. There's no doubt about that. You know, we can't think we're out of the bush because we got 400,000 people in another month still waiting for to get a vaccine. So we need to encourage vaccine. That's why vaccine incentives are important. That's what we're going to be announcing in some detail next week. In terms of the public health issue, it's so clear to the vast majority of people that the best thing to do here is to stay safe, follow the public health orders, and get a vaccine. And it's so difficult to understand why people can't get that message. This is why we stepped up enforcement beginning last fall and much more so into this year. Hundreds of people, in fact, now it's into the thousands of people helping us with this, and increased our penalties, doubled our fines, and doubled, in effect, put way more boots on the ground. So, you know, we're enforcing as best we can. We're stepping that up. These measures today strengthen what were already very, very strong public health restriction orders. And again, the compliance rate will be a key factor in determining the rate of recovery against COVID. Oh, Clay's coming on.
We will try one more time, Mr. Premier. Clay, are you on the line? Well, technology is fabulous when it works. I believe that's it, sir.
I'll wind this up by just saying thanks to Dr. Roussin again and to his team for their work, to say thank you to the federal government for responding, Prime Minister and his team for responding to us. I anticipate more resources coming from the federal government to support us. The intent of some of those is most certainly to reduce the likelihood of us needing to transport as many people, but there will be the need, as we know, that ICU demands will follow because of the high number of hospitalizations presently, that ICU demands will not be dissipating in the next few weeks. I would also say, if I could, close by inviting everyone to go and use for the first time a super site which will allow walk-in appointments at the Lidl location only. This would be today and tomorrow until we go completely through the supply we have on site. So get over there, get your vaccine. If I sound like Kern Hill Co-op right now and I'm imploring you, I am imploring you to use this. While we do have plans on how to use these next week, if they're still there, I'd hope they're not there. I'd hope that you all go and get your vaccine right now at Lila location. This is the Moderna mRNA vaccine. It's safe. It's highly effective. You can come in for your first dose if you're 18 plus. If you're eligible for your second, you can also go over to the Lila location and get that vaccine. So anybody who had their first dose before March 29th is able to go. Any Indigenous Manitoban is eligible to go. And if you have a pre-existing condition as outlined by the clinical team on protectmb.ca, you know the story. If you got your first dose already, you know this. The site is at 770 Lila. It'll be open both days, I'm told, from 9 a.m. to 8 p.m. I encourage everyone to go, and if I could be permitted a personal thing, I just wanted to say to Larry Cush, I understand you are going to be entering a new stage of your life, which won't involve quite as much work at the Free Press. I wanted to wish you the very best in your retirement. And if I could further use this brief time, I wanted to wish my wife, Esther, a happy 32nd anniversary. Thank you.